All right, good morning, Friars. Hope everything's going well. Hopefully by this point, we're into our third week of e-learning, and hopefully the last week of agriculture. And this time I promise I'm not telling stories. All right, we're going to finish up our study of agriculture looking at agribusiness. All right, so agribusiness is defined as the business that provides or businesses that provide a vast array of goods and services to support the agricultural industry, right? So not necessarily the farms themselves, but the businesses that support those farms. Agribusiness is basically changing the geography of agriculture, right? Crops are much more commercialized than they used to, and so they are drawing in other businesses, right? New technologies. They are changing the way farmers operate, right? It used to be you did it all yourself. And in a lot of places around the world, they still do it all themselves. But in places where we see a lot of commercial farming, and this is predominantly in the core, some semi-periphery and peripheral countries, again, those farms are probably owned by foreign corporations. This agribusiness has kind of sprouted up around them. Right. It's agribusiness serves to connect local farms in a spatially extensive web of production and exchange. Right. It in some ways fosters agriculture to become spatially concentrated. OK, so let's start with the U.S. poultry industry. Right. We're looking at broiler chicken sales in the United States. Right. And you can see that they are primarily concentrated in the South. And there are a couple of reasons for that, right? One is, what's a big meal in the southern part of the United States? Fried chicken, right? So we're going to sell more chickens in this part of the United States than probably others. But also, too, if you were to look at not just where we sell the chickens, but what businesses are related or are located there, you're going to find this agribusiness being very predominantly displayed, right? Let's look at East Texas for a second, right? In East Texas, there are a lot of chicken farms. You will find that there used to be, I don't know if it's even still in business, but a company called Pilgrim's Pride. They had a large series of chicken farms in the United States. So you have the farms that raise the chickens, right? Near them, you're going to have the processing plants, where those chickens are processed into broilers, right? Their feathers are taken off and cut up into nice little pieces so that we can use them, right? What else would you find in that particular area? Well, you're probably going to find companies that specialize in providing services for those particular chicken farms. Things like, you know, if there's pens or feeder systems or even the feed themselves. Right, you may find in that area, if you're going to be selling chickens in this particular area, you want to be offering fresh chickens. And fresh chickens mean that you're going to have them near where your market is. Right, if I am going to sell chickens, right, I'm not going to put my farm up in northern Montana. As you can see, there's not a lot of chicken sales there. I'm sure there are, but not as many as you see in the South. Right, if you remember Von Thunen's model, I'm not going to put things that are perishable, right? I know we can freeze chickens, but we're not going to add transportation costs to perishable goods to transport them all the way from Montana to their home or ultimate point of sale in the southern part of the United States, right? If I'm a good business person, I'm going to put my farm and my businesses where the market is, right? If we remember back to our studies regarding the Ford Motor Company in Detroit, Michigan, right? We know that they are located near an area where they could get all their supplies. Well, if you go to Detroit nowadays, you will find that there are a lot of tire companies that are there, window, you know, like automobile windows companies that are there. People that make parts for the Ford Motor Company plant, because they don't make as many, you know, products as they used to, and we'll talk about that in another chapter. But there are the companies now that supply them, right? You're going to go where they're needed so you can reduce your transportation costs. Similarly, let's look at, hog farms, right, in the United States, right? And again, you're going to see that they are located primarily in a couple of places, right? Midwest and in South Carolina or North Carolina. But let's look at the Midwest for just a second, right? If you are familiar with hogs and pigs, and I don't expect many of you are, they eat a lot of things, but they love corn, right? Where is corn grown primarily in the United States? Missouri, Nebraska, Iowa, Illinois, southern Minnesota. So you're going to see again that this is where the climate encourages or is perfect for corn growth. So why not put your farm in a place where you're going to be close to your food supply, right? And again, if you went to these areas, not only are you going to find corn, but you're going to find all the products and businesses that support the hog and pig industry in the United States. If we look at North Carolina, there is, I've read numbers of stories about the hog and pig industry in North Carolina. And again, some unintended consequences. Pigs are kind of, they are clean animals, but they produce a lot of dirt and a lot of waste. And there's a huge problem in North Carolina with what do you do with all that waste? And some of the farmers have been improperly disposing of it by sloughing it off into the rivers in North Carolina. And so it's become a big environmental issue for them as well. When we're looking at agribusiness, right, particularly again in the core, right, the core has a, puts this core in a position to have control of land use decisions, like in North Carolina, and a disproportionate role in deciding what will be bought at what price. The colonial era leaves these commercial farms, whether they be animal livestock raising or crop raising, right, at the mercy of the core, right? The core owns the land. The core decides what will be planted, how much will be planted, and what they're going to turn around and then charge the periphery for them. Remember, most of these things are exported, and then the core countries or companies will ship them back to market in those countries. So again, there isn't much that the periphery can do about it. All right, let's talk about our last subject, and that is environmental impacts of commercial farming. Right, commercial agriculture produces a significant amount of food for the rest of the world, but it also produces a really significant environmental changes. As again, more countries become developed, they want a more protein-based diet, much like you see in the West, right? West being Western Europe, North America. When you start to demand more, right, you have to have, there's stressors that are get putting on the environment, right? People want more fish, right? Fish is really healthy. So we overfish, right? We don't give the fish population a significant time to recover, right? So that farmer or fishermen who, let's say down in the Gulf, go out looking for fish, they have to go further and further out and they're finding less and less fish. So you often see this concept of farm-raised, right? So farms where all we do is raise fish. Japan has a great, what they call aquaponic system where they, you know, have farms out into the ocean of all these fish. But what harm is that doing to the environment? Additionally, as we want more and more cattle, right? We have to clear more and more land, and we've talked about the consequences of that, right? As we demand more food, we are, and partly because we have a greater population, right? We are needing more and more agricultural land. And as we need more and more agricultural land, we're causing additional soil erosion, chemical pollutants into the land, and some levels of deforestation as well. And then the question that we've talked about before with genetically modified foods, right? We don't know what, if any, problems those particular foods may be causing. because at this point they've just not been around long enough to do any kind of long-term studies. We know organic farming can benefit the environment to a certain extent because we are using more natural products and taking out those chemicals. But can we produce enough food to feed everybody? Organic farming is much more expensive and labor intensive, which raises the price, which may put those kinds of foods out of some people's hands. Environmental impacts of large-scale intense farming can be severe when we see agriculture moving into marginal environments, right? Marginal environments meaning those that barely support those particular types of that farming. And I'm going to see if I can get back to, I don't know, let's see. Let's keep going back a little bit. Give me a map. Not that map. All right, let's look over here in Sub-Saharan Africa, right? This area that we know is the Sahara has another area beneath it called the Sahel, S-A-H-E-L, right? It is less arid than the Sahara, but certainly not as much rain as you're going to see as you move farther down into the more tropical areas of Africa, right? The Sahel is being farmed as much as it can because of the fact that there is an increasing population, right, in Africa. Right here, of course, is Nigeria, which is one of the fastest growing countries in the world. They need more food. So we are working in an area that is more marginally amenable to agriculture, right? Which means that this area cannot sustain agriculture as well. It cannot sustain farming as well as the herds of animals that eat all the vegetation there, which again is leading to that increase or spread of the Sahara southward, right? As we are becoming more and more of a Western diet, and even, let's say, a fast food diet, right? Because Western diets really want to have things quick and easy, right? We are needing more and more land for all of that meat, right? For all of the grains and what have you that are eventually processed. All right, the last thing we're going to talk about in the next chapter is ending this chapter, right? Talking about the challenges of feeding the population as it's growing. There's that darn thing again. Particularly, we're going to revisit Malthus just a little bit. So finish this up and answer the questions, and then we'll move on to the next one. Thanks.